webinar today on the Florida Whistleblower Act. If anybody has any problems and cannot hear me, there's a little spot to type a question, so please shoot me a little note and tell me that you're having a problem with the audio or with the picture. Also, I'm going to try to take questions as we go along, but if I don't answer your question, I promise I will get to them at the end. And also, at the end, I'll have my email again, so if anybody has any questions after the seminar and you want to shoot me an email, please feel free to do. So the reason I picked the Florida Whistleblower Act to talk about is because in 21 years of doing employment law, employment defense, I have found that there has been a dramatic increase in the number of whistleblower claims I've seen, and because I think the plaintiff's bar has taken a hold of this act, even though it's been around for a while, because it gets them into court a lot faster than it does a discrimination claim. So they can start the ball rolling with discovery and then eventually a lot of them amend it and add some type of discrimination or retaliation claim under the Florida Civil Rights Act or under Title VII or any of the other discrimination laws. So we're going to talk a little bit about, you know, what comes under the act, what is a whistleblower. You know, generally it's a person who exposes some kind of misconduct or dishonest or illegal activity in an organization. And the term was actually coined by Ralph Nader in the 70s because he didn't like the fact that at that point they were calling people snitches. And so he was trying to find a kinder word for them, and so he called them whistleblowers. And that's the term we see today. And there's lots of laws that prohibit whistleblowing. We've got the False Claim Act, which is, you know, allowing a citizen to actually step into the shoes of the government and sue if they believe that there's an organization or a person who's defrauding a governmental program, and the person who sues gets to keep a percentage of the damages. There's a Florida actually has a Florida False Claims Act, so when there's some kind of whistleblowing that somebody is defrauding a governmental program. Sarbanes-Oxley's been in the news a lot, and you know, the whistleblowing, there's a whistleblower provision of that for publicly traded companies, Dodd-Frank Act, and of course there's 21 whistleblower laws under OSHA. So there's lots of different ways whistleblowers get into court. But what we're going to talk about today are Florida's Private Whistleblower Act and their Public Whistleblower Act. And they're not that different anymore. There used to be some pretty significant differences between them, but now we're seeing that they are very close because of the new emerging case law. They're very close in what they prohibit. And we're going to talk a little bit about the public, but mostly we're going to be talking about the Private Whistleblower Act. And so under the Private Whistleblower Act, and a private employer is prohibited from taking a retaliatory personnel action based upon an employee's participation in one of three types of conduct. And one of the things that you'll notice as we go through the Whistleblowing Act and what is prohibited is it'll sound a lot like retaliation under the Discrimination Act. You know, under Title VII, you can't retaliate against somebody who's brought a claim, even if it's an internal claim, of discrimination. You can't take a retaliatory action on that. And so you'll see that these whistleblower statutes in a lot of ways sound like retaliation claims, and we'll later talk about the fact that the courts follow the federal requirements and burden shifting that they do in a retaliation claim, a Title VII case. So it's the same burden that you have to prove. So retaliatory personnel action, what are those fancy legal words mean? And it's basically, did you do something to the employee because they blew the whistle or you thought they blew the whistle? Did you terminate them? Did you suspend them, demote them, or any type, move them to a job they didn't like, take duties away from them? It really can be anything that affects their terms and conditions of employment. So what are the three types of protected whistleblowing conduct? The first one is disclosure. You know, when an employee says, I'm going to go report you to OSHA, or I'm going to go report you to whatever your governing, perhaps you're regulated by a governmental agency, Environmental Protection Agency. They're saying, I'm going to go report you. They don't actually have to do it. They can just threaten to do it. That's disclosure. The other kind is called assistance. Sometimes it's called participation. I gave you both words because you'll see both. They'll say that's participation whistleblowing or assistance whistleblowing. And this is can be testifying or providing information to an ongoing investigation or inquiry. So if somebody has made a complaint to a governmental agency and somebody else is giving them information, that in of itself is protected by the Florida Whistleblower Act. And the last one, and this is by far the most common, is objection or opposition. And this is when an employee objects to or refuses to participate in any activity, policy, or practice of an employer, which is a violation of a law, rule, or regulation. Now, we've seen case law where they're saying it's an internal rule, like a policy, a handbook, something like that. That is not going to be protected whistleblowing. They're talking about legislative rules, regulations, and laws. And when we talk, we'll talk a little bit, it's a little bit even narrower for public sector whistleblowing. So, do we have to give, does the employee have to give you notice? Do they have to tell you before they go report you to someone else or participate in an investigation or oppose, do they have to, if they're opposing something that you're doing, do they have to give you notice? And the courts have said only for disclosure. So what is required, though, before, and this is actually a little stopgap, a little protection for employees, is before they go and report you to a governmental agency, they have to give you both written notice and a reasonable opportunity to cure. So there is not protected with, you know, the statute doesn't protect somebody who just runs to, I guess, the old phrase, snitch, somebody who just goes to a governmental agency and reports their employer. They do not get whistleblowing protection. They're actually barred from bringing suit. They have to give the employer notice, written notice, and reasonable opportunity to cure. What I find, though, in these cases is that most of these cases will come under opposition, because opposition or participation do not require advance notice. And what an employee will say is, well, yeah, I said that I might be reporting it to a governmental agency, but actually I was objecting to it too, so it came under both. And they'll be able to survive in the lawsuit on the fact that they've opposed an action. So they don't have to give assistance or opposition. And what the courts have said on opposition is, you know, especially when you're asking an employee to participate in something, that if an employer says to an employee, here, go shred all these incriminating documents, that the employee doesn't need to go to their computer and write an email saying, you have asked me to do something that is in violation of the law. That a lot of times with an opposition or an objection, that employees are put on the spot and they don't have to give any kind of written notice to the employer. All they have to do is tell them. So, but now we get to our little chicken little. What if the employee thinks he, you know, is hit by an acorn and thinks the sky is falling? And what if they're wrong? What if an employee is complaining about something that the employer is doing and it's unlawful? Now, this is the one area where the two statutes used to split, because it used to be that the majority of the courts, and I don't want to say used to be, because the majority of the lower courts still have ruled that it requires an actual violation of law, rule, or regulation, meaning that what they were complaining about actually has to be violative of the law, regardless of whether, you know, the employee may have thought something was violation of the law and it wasn't. They didn't protect the employees who are, it used to not protect employees who were wrong. But the public whistleblower always did. It said if you had a good faith belief, that was enough. But that has not been the case in the private sector. Most of the lower courts have ruled that it requires an objection to an actual violation of the law, what the person has to be doing. Because I've had cases before where an employee is complaining and saying, you're not allowed to do this, and you're saying, yes, you are. I had a case where this employee felt, or she was positive that her employer was violating HIPAA, and the employer kept trying to tell them that they weren't violating HIPAA, they weren't subject to HIPAA, and they kept telling her over and over again, and she still was very, very insistent on it, and they terminated her for other reasons, but she brought a whistleblower claim, and they found that, well, there wasn't an actual violation of the law. She was wrong. But now what's happened, there's been an interesting change that's very recent. And although 2013 isn't recent, what has come because of this case, I call it Scary Airy. There is a case called Airy versus Wallace Lincoln Mercury of Lake Park, which was in the 4th District Court of Appeal, which is just one of the 5 district courts in Florida. And it was the first case that has ruled on the standard of proof in a private whistleblower case, which you'd think it would have made it to an appellate court on that issue before, but it hadn't. So this was the first time. And John Airy worked as an automobile parts manager at a Lincoln Mercury, maroon Lincoln Mercury in Lake Park. And shortly into his employment, he began to notice some suspicious dealings by the dealership's body shop manager, and he claimed that the body shop manager was involved in this insurance scam with fraudulent invoices. And what was happening was, when somebody would bring in their car for the repair, the body shop manager would place 2 separate orders to vendors, one for a used part and one for a new part. Well, they would put the used part in and take the and return the new part, but he would still have the invoice. So he was invoicing for a new part to the insurance company. Well, Airy reported this to the general manager and said, you know, this is illegal. I don't know what law it violates, but I'm pretty sure it's illegal. And the general manager said to Airy, you know, look, I'm going to straighten this out. But months passed, nothing happened, and he continued to tell his general manager, and then he took it up the ladder to corporate, and corporate said, well, we're going to do something about it, but nothing ever happened. And then almost a year later, they fired him, and they said it was a reduction in force, although it was a reduction in force of 1. He was the only person who was terminated. And so he brought suit under the Florida Whistleblower Act, and the trial court granted the employer's motion for summary judgment and dismissed the case. And one of the arguments that the employer argued on appeal was that Airy didn't state a cause of action because he didn't tell his employer what laws that they were breaking and couldn't identify what laws they were breaking. Well, the 4th District Court disagreed, and they said, you know, it's not necessary that Airy provide his employer with a statutory and case law citations. He just needed a good faith belief that it was illegal. And so this is the first time that the actual violation standard was not applied in an appellate court. And so this the actual violation standard puts a much higher burden on the plaintiff, on the employee. And so now it's a lot easier because they just have to have this good faith belief. Now, the way this works is that this is now, for federal cases, all 3 federal courts, the Southern, the Middle, and the Northern District of Florida, have all applied Airy because it's the only appellate case on the issue, and the Supreme Court hasn't ruled. So there's still a question out there of whether the other district courts are going to disagree or whether the Supreme Court is actually going to step in, which leaves us with the question, okay, well, what's the standard now? Do we have to look to our employees and say, you know, you don't know what you're talking about, or do we have to take all of them seriously because it just takes a good faith belief on the part of the employee? And what I've been advising clients now is, for now, assume a good faith belief is enough, because as long as ARI's the only appellate, you know, state appellate case out there, that's the law that's going to be applied until there's another appellate court addresses the issue. So a good faith belief is enough. So if Chicken Little thought the sky was falling, even though it was an acorn, and he believed that, then that would probably be enough to state a claim. So, and we're going to talk a little bit about public. The Public Whistleblower Act prohibits agencies and independent agency contractors, which are people who are actually contracting with the government, from retaliating against employees and persons who make certain disclosures. The Public Whistleblower Act is actually interesting because it's not just employees. It actually applies to people who don't even work for the government can bring a claim of retaliation. So does the disclosure go to a matter of public concern? This is where it's a little bit of narrower on what is a protected disclosure. It has to be something that's a substantial danger to the public health, safety, or welfare. So I actually litigated a whistleblower case last year where the employee claimed that her boss, she was a note taker in meetings, and the notes were actually published on the internet so people could see, because they're a public sector client and in the public records law and under the Sunshine Laws, they had to disclose them. So she took notes of the meeting, and she had a dispute with her boss over, he corrected her notes before they were put on the internet, and she had a dispute with her boss over the accuracy. She thought that he had misrepresented what was said in the meeting, which was a little ironic because the tape of the meeting was also on there, so somebody could actually listen to it. But they disputed what was being said, and he thought that she had a fundamental misunderstanding about what they were talking about, and so her notes were inaccurate. And she went to the committee and told them she thought the notes were, and this case actually went all the way to the 11th Circuit. We won a summary judgment, and then the 11th Circuit affirmed, and I was able to get attorney's fees because the court said, no, this is definitely not a whistleblower action. Now, while it is a matter of public concern about that, we want to make sure that we're accurately portraying this. This is really an internal conflict that you had. This is not a whistleblower action. So in the public sector, you're still looking for, is it something that the public is going to affect the public? The second protected disclosure is an act or suspected act of gross mismanagement, misfeasance, waste of funds, or gross neglect of duty. So when somebody is disclosing, an employee is complaining about how somebody, a manager or somebody, is spending governmental funds, or how they're managing their department to the point of wasting governmental funds, that could be a protected whistleblower thing under the public sector. So now, a protected whistleblower and persons under that in the public sector, it has to be written and signed. Written and signed complaint under the public sector. But what's interesting is even though the statute says written and signed, there's been case law that have allowed emails to suffice. I guess in the electronic age, an email can be considered a written and signed document. The second one, so the first one is similar disclosure, just like with the private sector participation, and the third one is opposition. So it's the same three types of protected disclosures are in public and private. So what do we do now? Here we are, and I've given you this law, and you're like, okay, well, what do I do now? You know, what do I do when an employee complains? Are they actually a whistleblower? And we have to look at the context of complaints. What is it that they're complaining about? Are they making an internal complaint about our operations, or is it something beyond that? And when we're dealing with an employee, I mean, I have this little tightrope walker. I thought it was funny when I saw this down this image because it's so true. It is a tightrope on what you're doing. You know, it's so hard when you're in practice, in your practical application of being a manager or working with employees, and people complain and people don't like things. And, you know, if everyone was a whistleblower case, I mean, you wouldn't be able to run your organization. So how do we find that fine line between managing an employee and avoiding a retaliation claim? You know, one of the things that we have to know, first of all, is at the very essence of a whistleblower action is an adverse employment action of some time. What we talked, a retaliatory personnel action. Something has to have been done to the employee. Just because we didn't do what they wanted to in terms of our response to their complaint, the employee's going to have to show we did something to them, that we fired them, we demoted them, we took duties away from them, that we changed something in the term and condition of their employment. And then we've got to show a connection to that complaint. So they have to be able to connect the dots. And that is such the essence of any type of retaliation claim, just like with whistleblower or just with a retaliation claim under the Americans with Disabilities Act, under the ADEA, under Title VII. Anytime an employee is saying you retaliated against me, which is what a whistleblower case is, they're saying you retaliated against me for making this whistleblower complaint. And anytime you've got a retaliation complaint, you have to connect the dots. This is the essence of it. You've got to have that adverse employment action, and then they have got to connect the dots between that and their complaint. So how do they connect the dots? This is normally where they start. The first thing they have to say is the person knew I made the complaint. The decision maker knew. Now, does that end the ball game for them? No, absolutely not. It doesn't. But sometimes, you know, when something has come up the chain, a complaint has come up the chain, it may be in your interest not to let a lower level supervisor know, the person who's dealing with them day to day. And then when that person is taking an action, you can say, well, they didn't even know. How is that retaliation? They didn't know that you had made this complaint. But sometimes that's not feasible, or it's not practical, that a lot of times the complaint is made to the person who's the decision maker. So, but that is definitely one of the ways to connect the dots, is the decision maker knew of the protected activity. They're going to look at time. Timing is always critical in retaliation cases. How close is the time? They made the complaint, but next week you fire them. But in the Airy case, they fired him a year later. Now, normally in most retaliation cases, a year would be too long a proximity of time. They would find that there was no causal connection with a year. But in this case, he kept making the complaint. He kept talking to people about it. So the court said, well, no, we're not going to go from the first time he made the complaint. We're going to look at all the time he made the complaint. Even if it was a year later, those dots are still connected. So close proximity is definitely can be held as evidence of a causal connection. Inconsistencies in an explanation for an adverse employment action. This is always a very difficult thing that we get as defense attorneys. I have this in discrimination cases and retaliation cases, and it'll apply to whistleblower cases too, where I will sit down with my client who's been sued, and they will talk to me about why this person was terminated, and then I start digging a little bit more and digging a little bit more, and I find that there is some inconsistencies in our stated reason. And maybe they'll say, well, you know, we fired them. The person was just not working out. They were not a good performer. And I start looking into it a little bit more and find that the employee was making complaints about something, or the employee didn't get along with somebody who wanted them out, and they weren't exactly applying the policies in a uniform way. So anytime we have inconsistencies in our explanation of why we're doing something, you know, that is also, the courts have found another way for them to connect the dots. Also, I mean, this is, seems pretty logical, when, if we start treating the person differently, if they can say, well, look, you know, I was a star performer for them, and then after I made this complaint that I thought what they were doing was wrong, all of a sudden, persona non grata, and they don't, you know, they, no one was asking me to lunch, no one was, you know, they weren't giving me plum assignments anymore, they moved me to an office with no windows that smelled bad, and, you know, I wasn't invited to the company picnic or whatever it is. Now, they still have to have that adverse employment action that we fired them or did something to them. That's not enough, but they can use that other anecdotal evidence to show, look, I'm gonna connect these dots because I'm going to show you how different it was before I made that complaint and after I made that complaint. So, and as I said before, it's the same burden shifting that is in Title VII. So what happens is that whistleblower will say, okay, well, I made a protected whistleblowing, you know, activity. Here's what I did. I disclosed this. I objected to this, or I participated in this hearing or inquiry. And then the burden shifts to the employer to show a legitimate non-retaliatory reason for our adverse action. And we say, well, I know that he had complained to the EEOC that we had discriminatory hiring practices, but that's not why we fired him. He did that because he's been on probation for the last 6 months, and you know, we've warned him about his production and he didn't improve it. And so one of the things that we always go to the heart to of defending any type of discrimination or retaliation case is, what's our legitimate business reason for what we did? Can we justify it? And this is also an exercise that I go through with my clients when they're calling me saying, okay, Dina, I'm ready to let this person go. And I say, well, why? why are you letting them go? What are we gonna tell the court if they sue? I always play this little game of, you're on the, you know, you're being deposed. What would we say, and how would we defend this, and how would we defend this, and how would we defend the fact that we've never terminated someone under that policy before, or that we're applying this policy a lot harsher and we've allowed other people to slip by, that we're making sure it's a legitimate business reason, that we've been consistent, and that if we haven't been consistent, if we're doing something different for this employee, that we have a legitimate business reason as to why. You know, well, yes, we've allowed other people to work outside, but we haven't allowed other people to work outside when it undermines our business or when they're defaming us outside of work. In their secondary job, and we have evidence that this person is defaming us. So if we're doing something different, that we have an explanation for it, and that we have documentary support. Documents are so critical in these cases. You know, have we documented the issues that we have that we can show are separate and apart from a whistleblower claim? And also documenting, and we're going to talk a little bit about what to do when we get these claims, but also the documents are so important in how we handle a complaint, that we're taking them seriously. And we need to take them all seriously now, because all the employee needs is a good faith belief, which is a very low standard. We need to make sure that we're documenting not only what the employee says, but what we're saying to the employee, what they do, that they're signing off on, that this is their complaint, that we have it accurately documented. So often these cases are won and lost by the documents. And a lot of times managers or co-employees will think that emails are gone or documents that they've deleted are no longer accessible, which is, you know, everybody knows is not true. You know, in this day and age, they can find out anything. And whenever I go do training, I always tell managers, you know, if you wouldn't stand up in a church or a synagogue and say it out loud, you probably don't want to be putting in an email, because if it ends up and as part of a lawsuit, they'll read it in court. and it's not very fun. So these documents and what employees are writing are very important, and one of the reasons why you really want to make sure your managers and supervisors are so well trained, because the things they do and say and the documents that they create are very important in protecting your organization from liability in these retaliation claims or whistleblower actions or in discrimination cases. So now, how do we avoid whistleblower claims? Well, I guess the first thing would be to, I'm going to assume that everybody's following the law and doing everything their organization is supposed to do. So what do we do when we're doing that and we get somebody who's blowing the whistle anyway on something that maybe is not as legitimate? First of all, we need to make sure we respond to these complaints. We don't let them fester. And even if you're hearing that these complaints are being made sort of internally and they haven't actually officially brought it, I would bring the employee in and talk to them, because you want to make sure that we are addressing these complaints as they come out and that we can show that we're being proactive. So respond to employee complaints and don't take them personally. You know, I think a lot of times, especially with whistleblower complaints, and I've had this many times with my clients, and I don't blame them. It's terrible to be accused of something, and especially if it's something you didn't do. Or if it's something that was going on in your organization and you didn't know about it, and you're like, well, I didn't even know this was going on. So you can't take these complaints personally. You've got to just make sure that we take them all serious, you know, take all of them seriously. And the thing we want to do is also maintain confidentiality, because like I was saying before, the more you can put, you know, a cocoon around the people who know, the less chances of having a retaliation claim if somebody outside of that cocoon takes some kind of action, or somebody else is complaining, you know, a coworker is complaining that, you know, Bob isn't doing his part, and you know, he's not working and he's coming in late, or Carolyn is not doing her work, or Maureen, and then you say, well, you know, and we look into it and we find it's right and we discipline them, and they say, oh, you disciplined me because of my complaint. And when you're able to shield the decision makers from that, you have an absolute defense to it. I didn't know. How could I be retaliating against you on something I didn't even know about? So we try to maintain confidentiality to the extent I can. Don't promise complete confidentiality to employees, because you can't guarantee it. You want to do it to the extent you're able to do it. So, and then we want to make sure your anti-retaliation policy is strong. A lot of companies now actually have, especially larger companies, have whistleblowing policies that have a point person or sometimes a third-party organization where if you think something is not being done correctly, it gives them a number to call or a person to go to. I don't find for most organizations that that's necessary. I think an anti-retaliation provision is fine, an open-door policy that we take complaints seriously and that we listen to them, and that it is an absolute violation of our policy for somebody to retaliate against somebody who's made a complaint. Whether it's a complaint of discrimination or a complaint of something in your operation. So make sure your anti-retaliation policy is strong. And as I've said repeatedly, we need to make sure our managers and supervisors are trained. It's just so important to make sure that this frontline people who are dealing with the employees on a day-to-day basis know what they're supposed to be doing and saying and not doing and saying. And also that the little notes that they're writing to themselves and sticking in a file can one day be, you know, Exhibit A on a document. And so that we want to be really careful that they understand in part of what how they're operating and interacting with their employees. And then once we know that somebody has made, somebody is complaining about, let's say somebody is saying, you know, my supervisor, I believe, is, you know, putting in these illegal, in these used parts, we definitely want to, if we can, separate the person who might possibly retaliate against them from the person who is accusing them. We want to shield them as much as possible. But and sometimes this is a very difficult thing to do when, and I've seen it even just in employment discrimination cases where somebody is still working and makes a complaint of discrimination without seeming like you're retaliating against the employee, because a lot of times it's easier to move the employee than it is a supervisor. And these are really fact-based things that are difficult sometimes to that employers struggle with, is how do we do this when I've got somebody who's making this complaint so we don't end up with a retaliation complaint on top of it. And it's really going to be a fact-by-fact thing. But if you can separate them, it's always very helpful. And then investigate thoroughly. And a lot of times these investigations can easily be handled in-house. Sometimes if the allegations are bad enough, or depending on what the positions are, you might need to get a third party to come in and do an investigation. But one of the things you want to make sure you do is to, and I always advise people to do this at the onset, because I've seen it in several cases over 21 years of doing just employment law, that I've seen cases where it always comes back, you know, in hindsight 2020, where the employee's saying, well, they didn't talk to so-and-so, and they didn't talk to so-and-so. So one of the things you definitely want to do, especially with somebody who's bringing a complaint, is making sure you get the names of all the witnesses and everyone that they think has relevant information. So we can say, well, I spoke to everybody that this person identified as being a person of knowledge. And also that the investigation is documented, and that the complainant is notified. One of the things that happens sometimes is an investigation is conducted and something happens, and then no one bothers to get back to the person who complained because you think you took care of it. And it's crucially important for I apologize if anyone can hear. I have a fire truck that's going by our office, and we're on the ninth floor, but it must be pretty loud. Apologize if that's coming through. But anyway, one of the things that happens a lot of times with investigations is that an investigation's conducted, and then nobody bothers to get back to the complaining party. You definitely want to get back to the complaining party and tell them what your determination is. A lot of times, you know, it might be a he said, she said kind of thing where you can't really get to the bottom of it, but you'll have to, as an organization, make a decision in how you're going to determine what the validity of it and whether you're going to take any type of action based on that. And one of the things that the courts have been pretty lenient about, which I like, is that it doesn't necessarily always have to be what the employee wants you to do, although I think it's a necessary part of an investigation to ask them and find out what that is. But if there's something remedial that you feel the employer feels helps solve this issue, you can do it. Maybe an employee doesn't like something and thinks that there's a process that's a violation of a law the way you're doing it, and maybe it's not technically, but you know, and they want you to do it X way, and you're like, well, that's too expensive, but we're going to do it this way instead. That's okay. Or even if it's somebody's complaint, you know, I'm complaining, this guy's bothering me, and we're like, well, okay, you don't report to him anymore. And she's like, well, I don't want him to be in the building anymore. And you're like, well, no, we're not going to do that. I mean, we don't always have to take what the employee wants, but we just have to make sure that what we're doing is sufficiently remedial to fix the problem. And as I said, we need to take complaints seriously. Even if we know the employee is incorrect, if they believe they're correct and they have a good faith belief, now, you know, there's always a fine line of somebody who's just pressing something that they know is wrong. You're like, they know it's not true. We know it's not true. It's a fine line. You can't go wrong erring on the side of taking it seriously, looking like you're taking it seriously, investigating it, and even if your investigation determines, okay, we were right, we're not in the wrong this time, the employee's wrong, but that you still taking it seriously, that we're not doing any kind of chill effect to future complaints, because that's one of the things the courts do not like, is any type of action by the employer that might get out to other employees and chill them or stop them from making a future complaint. So this is probably the biggest thing to do to avoid whistleblower claims. If somebody's made a complaint that could possibly be considered a whistleblower claim and we're ready to take some kind of action against them is really to assess the risk. What do we have here? Do we have a causal connection or an apparent causal connection? Is the employee going to be able to connect the dots? I mean, they just made this complaint. Now, what unfortunately happens for employers is a lot of times people will make a whistleblower or just, you know, another type of complaint, that a protected activity, you know, which is bringing a claim of discrimination or something like that, when they know the writing's on the wall and they're doing that. And so, you know, then we're like, okay, well, what's the risk now? How well have we documented prior to that complaint? And these are so fact-specific, and a lot of times they can be tricky, and this is, you know, this is usually a time where you want to, especially if it's been a whistleblower complaint, you want to get legal counsel in and just pick up the phone and make a quick call and say, look, here's our fact scenario, and, you know, they made this complaint, you know, 2 months ago, we looked at it, it wasn't valid, you know, we were talking about terminating them before, but we really are ready to pull the trigger now, what are our risks? And we're going to look at all these different things, the timing, how do we respond to it, how have we done it in the past, have we had anybody else make it, you know, and that's one of the reasons why HR departments are so important, especially in larger organizations. I always describe them as the umbrella, that a lot of times the right hand doesn't know what the left hand does, but the umbrella knows, because the umbrella goes over the whole thing and protects the whole organization. And so that's why it's so important, if you do have an HR person or an HR staff, to get human resources involved in these things, because they'll know what the precedent is in your organization. So also, when we're dealing with performance issues, because as I said before, it's not uncommon that a disgruntled employee is having performance issues may make a whistleblower complaint. Now, that doesn't mean that there's not legitimate whistleblower complaints out there. Ari obviously had a legitimate whistleblower complaint. He was, you know, this guy was putting in used parts and telling the person that he fixed their car with new parts. You know, that's clearly a subject of a valid whistleblower complaint, but a lot of times they come in the context of poor performance. And so what do we do then? Well, first of all, we go back to that old documentation. I mean, I think I'm a broken record when it comes to this, because we want to document. And I always find, you know, this happens so often where I will have a phone call with a client and he'll say, you know, we are just done, and, you know, we're done with this person, we've had all kinds of performance issues, it's well documented, and, you know, and I will get the folder, and maybe the person just came back from FMLA leave, or maybe something, you know, they made a complaint about something or whatever, and I'll get the folder, and the recent activities have been documented, but the last evaluation was all excellence, and the evaluation before that was, you know, superior employee, and the employee got an award a year before for being the greatest employee that there ever was. And so, you know, it's so hard because you're stuck with those documents, and what do they say? What's the story that somebody would read if they read that document about that employee? What would they think? Would they think, you know, oh, well, let's see, you gave him best employee of the year last year, and now you're saying it's the worst employee that ever happened. So we need to be able to look at our documents and say, how objective are they and how accurate are they? And that is also, especially with evaluations. And this is my great legal advice here, be fair. But what I mean by this is we want to make sure that we're even-handed in how we are applying things, that especially for that employee of the year who's having a bad year this year. Is there something going on with the employee? Have we given a pass to other employees who've had difficult times? Have we been consistent in how we're applying our policies and our standards of what we're expecting from them? And don't terminate on the spot. You know, especially with whistleblowers and when people are inaccurate in their whistleblowing is very, it's a very bad place for employers to be. They don't like it. I don't blame them. You know, I had this before. I had a whistleblower case where someone was, the employee was saying that they were violating the sunshine law, and the employee just did not really understand the provisions of the Sunshine Law that they were talking about. It was governing collective bargaining, and the employee was insistent and kept bringing her boss articles and highlighting it, and she was just hounding him and hounding him and hounding him that he was violating the Florida Sunshine Act, and he kept saying, you're wrong. This is not the provision. This is not what it means. And we're not bargaining. And he was trying to explain it to her. And he finally had it, and he was very close. She was so persistent and quite honestly a little nasty about it that he was just ready to fire her. And luckily he slammed the door and put a hole in the wall instead, and then got on the phone and called me, and I talked him off the ledge and we calmed him down a little bit. But you don't want to terminate in anger, especially in light of these with these accusations. You want to make sure you've got all your ducks in a row. So that is our presentation today on the Whistleblower Act. It's something that we're going to see more of, because it allows plaintiffs to get into court quicker than in discrimination cases. And if anyone has any questions, please feel free to ask them now, or you're welcome to shoot me an email. And thank you all for being here. We're going to do another seminar. Our next one will be on non-competes. And if you have any other Florida ideas for under Florida law that you'd like to see in terms of our webinars, please let us know, and we will make sure to do a webinar on it. So everyone have a great afternoon. I don't see any questions. Thanks, everybody.